Wayne Grisham is dead.
A former VP at Grayson & Grayson Incorporated, he was overworked, overweight, and well now, just plain over. This is Wayne's boss, Jack Walters. He's president of acquisitions, a smart, decent man, as well-respected as anyone at G&G.
I can't believe it was a heart attack. He had the biggest heart of any man I knew.
Gail Koner, Jack's secretary. Is that grief in her eyes, or is she hiding something? Let's find out.
Gail.
Yes?
Jim Profit. I'm starting Monday. New junior VP acquisitions.
Oh, yeah, right. I saw the memo. How do you do?
Not exactly the best way to start a new job, is it? Taking over for someone as highly regarded as Wayne.
Yes, he was a nice man.
Yes, he was.
I'm sorry, I'm running a little late.
Yes, you're going to see your mother. Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, right? Most weekends. MS is a terrible disease. But still, any kind of life is better than the alternative.
I'm not sure I know what you mean.
You like to go to Zanderman's Deli, get her some chicken noodle soup. She really looks forward to that, doesn't she?
Look, I don't know what you're talking about.
I didn't tell you what department I used to work in, did I? Auditing. We check those long, boring columns of dollars and cents. And find that sometimes a few don't balance out. What you took was very modest, which is unusual for an embezzler.
Drink?
I had to run a lot of programs to find your pattern. You rounded every third, seventh, and ninth direct reinvestment from dividends down to the nearest hundredth of a penny and skimmed the balance. A few $100 a month to get your mother a better room is hardly a crime. 379, that was the key. They your lucky numbers?
Used to be.
Fortunately, Gail, I'm the only one who knows anything about this. I can go back to auditing and make the whole thing disappear. But I'm gonna have to ask you for one small favor.
What?
I could really use 20 uninterrupted minutes in your boss's computer.
Grayson & Grayson, spearheaded by its aggressive acquisitions policy, has a capital base of $14.8 billion, making it the 15th largest corporation in the world, and a very exciting place to work. Especially if you're willing to put in that extra time and effort it takes to get ahead. And there's plenty of room for career advancement as well. If you know what you want. I want to be president of acquisitions. Jack Walters' job.
Gail, turn on the computer. Okay, access Wilson. Open acquisitions. No. Get me into Jack Walters' office.
Senior staff or above can get in.
Gail.
G&G recently acquired a baby food company called Baby's Finest, whose apple juice, according to the AP files, is really nothing but sugar and water. Now, there was a lot of heated correspondence between our president of acquisitions and the CEO of Baby's Finest. Should G&G add real apple juice? The CEO's decision, no. Too expensive.
Daily Tribune.
The problem with cutting corners is it always comes back to haunt you. Charles Henry Grayson, Chaz to his friends. He's the son of the company's founder, and he was promoted to CEO 4 years ago. This morning, G&G stock plummeted. Charles lost $8 million.
My father called me at 4:30 this morning, read me the story. Everyone's seen it. We just paid $82 million for Baby's Finest, for a name that means trust. Oh, I want to know who leaked this, and I want to know it now.
I doubt he suspects Mary Miller. She's a senior VP who puts in 60-hour weeks. Of course, she was opposed to the baby food takeover. Pete Grayson, the other senior VP and Chas's younger brother. Of course, he feels he should be CEO. And then there's...
Who are you?
This is Jim Prophet, Chas, new junior VP taking over for Wayne.
First day?
Yes, sir.
Well, Jim, you know what that makes you? The only person in this room that I can trust.
That's a pretty sad commentary. But I'll tell you something even sadder. Every one of us is going to have to take a lie detector test.
Not in my division.
Why not? If one of us leaked the story...
Excuse me. I know it's not my place. But how do we know it was senior staff? Or even someone in this division? Anyone could have done it. I could have done it. I could have... I don't know. Found out something about Mr. Walter's secretary? Blackmailed her? Forced her to get me into the AP files?
He's right. Anybody could have done it. We have 38,000 employees worldwide. You want to give every one of them a lie detector test?
Grayson and Grayson is not just a company. Not to me, at least. It's a family. And if we start with lie detector tests, what's it going to be next week? Loyalty oaths? I won't take a lie detector test. I think it's wrong. If that means I shouldn't be a part of this division.
Prophet's right. You either trust the people who work for you, or you don't. I want every executive in your department thoroughly investigated.
Right.
Find Meltzer. Get her in my office now. Ohio gozaimasu.
Joanne Meltzer. She's the head of West Coast Security for Grayson & Grayson. According to her Keltner personality test, she is fanatical in pursuit of a goal. Her obsessive personality is undoubtedly the result of a severe childhood trauma, but it serves her well as an investigator. In her spare time, she enjoys helicopter skiing and Tai Chi. And she's a vegetarian. Joanne, with that lifestyle, I sure hope you're getting enough protein.
Good to see you.
Gosh, you look great.
Thank you. You look like you've been working too hard.
Yeah, we've had a little excitement around here lately.
Yeah, so I hear. See what we can do about that.
Look, I should say something.
No, you shouldn't. Let's start with whoever had access to these.
3 months too late, but I'm sorry.
For what? For having a wife that ran off on you, or for taking her back after you slept with me?
Therapy's going pretty well, I see.
All right. Let's start with whoever could have gotten into the access prohibited files.
Well, there's Pete and Mary. Pete's too dumb to think something like this, and Mary's too good a person.
You think?
Married to her job, company nun.
I arrested a nun once. Killed a priest.
Why?
He dumped her for a choir boy. Nobody's perfect, Jack.
I've worked here for 18 years. I would never do anything to harm this company. But you did oppose the Baby's Finest buyout. Because I felt it was bad for the company, as did a number of other executives.
Mary, you got a minute? I didn't know you had company.
Jim, come on in. I don't believe you've met our local inquisitor, Joanne Meltzer. This is Jim Prophet.
Nice to meet you.
How do you do?
You don't look like an inquisitor to me. Mary, can you proof these are the third quarter earnings for the chem division? It's kind of urgent. We go to printers in an hour. I'm sorry to interrupt you. Mary's got the best brain in the division. I intend to use it shamelessly and steal all the credit.
Well, I could see you have a lot of work to do. Thank you for your time, Mary. Nice to meet you, Mr. Prophet.
Nice to meet you, too.
I proofed these yesterday.
Yeah, I thought you might want to take another look at them.
No, you didn't. You thought you'd help me get rid of her. Thanks. I owe you one.
Hey, new kid in town. How do you like it?
Like everything, except the cafeteria. It's kind of difficult to get anything decent without meat in it.
Oh, you're a vegetarian?
I'm trying. I know it's the best thing for my health and the planet, but still, sometimes I slip, you know?
I don't suppose you have any idea who leaked the documents.
No.
What?
Well, whoever did it had a conscience.
How so?
I couldn't stand the idea of selling sugared water to babies. I mean, I might have done the wrong thing, but they had the right motive.
Oh, I think it was simpler than that.
Really?
Yeah. Someone with a lot of stock, got greedy, sold short, leaked the story, made a fast buck.
Wow. A dark view of humanity.
Professional hazard. That and details. I'm forever noticing useless details about people.
Like what?
You've had plastic surgery.
I have.
Just a little on the top of your right hand.
Wow. How'd you see that?
Actually, I felt it when we shook hands. It's good work. What was it, a burn?
Tattoo. I had it removed when I went to Wharton. Not a lot of graduate students with tattoos, you know.
Well, your secret's safe with me.
Thanks.
Looks like you've got someone waiting in your office.
Nice talking to you.
See you later.
Look at how you filled out. Used to be so skinny. You were always very mature for your age. So quiet, you know, like you was planning something big. You sure were, weren't you?
Roberta Monroe Stokowski, age 37. My stepmother, since I was 8.
How did you find me?
One of the money magazines at the doctor's. They had his picture of you in a little box on the back page. Boy Wonder beats IRS for Grayson and Grayson. Your hair was darker and you changed your name, but something in those eyes, girl, can't forget. Oh, yeah, you never did like TV much, did you? Of course, who can blame you after what happened and all? If you don't like it, turn it off. It won't bite you. Now, me, I love TV. Keeps me company. Of course, that's just a $30 job. Got my eye on this big 59-inch color one. Of course, you know, everything costs money.
It's good to see you, Bobby. I don't really see too many people from the old days.
Yeah, I bet. You don't mind me changing like this, do you? I mean, I just think of you as family. Speaking of which, wouldn't your daddy be proud if he could see what you made of yourself? Next time I see him, I'll have to be sure and tell him.
He's alive?
It's hard to believe, isn't it? He's not real clear every day. He sure looks different. Of course, third-degree burns will do that. He's been in pain pretty much around the clock all these years. Worse than if he died, really. Maybe that was the plan, huh, Jimmy?
I'd like to see him.
I don't think so. He didn't know I found you. Nobody does yet. Don't go thinking you're gonna find him behind my back. He's in a new town under a new name. I'm a diabetic.
Then you shouldn't shoot heroin.
$100,000 now, and 50 more every 3 months, or I tell your daddy I found you, and he tells the cops what you did and who you really are, Jimmy Stokowski.
Turn around. Turn around. You know, I missed you, Bobby.
Yeah. I missed you, too.
Take real good care of you.
Yeah, you are. Hey, Jimmy. Don't make me wait too long for the money or the other.
According to company records, his name was Arnold Stokowski, but he later changed it. We don't know to what.
Why?
Yeah. He held a minor amount of stock. We owe him some dividends. His last known address was the Good Samaritan Hospital in Tulsa, Oklahoma. But that was 13 years ago. I would start checking in every hospital that has a burn unit or nursing centers that care for burn patients.
Mm-hmm. Married?
Yeah.
Know anything about the wife?
Sometimes you have to put your personal problems on hold and attend to business first. Grayson & Grayson's annual tennis tournament to raise money for AIDS is one of the few chances we have to socialize and get to know each other on a personal level.
So Charles Grayson has a new mistress every year.
His only vice, other than wanton cruelty and insatiable greed.
What happened if his wife found out?
Snip, snip.
Ouch.
Who's that?
Jack's wife, Elizabeth. She's a Grayson, Chas's cousin. She's in recovery.
From what? Drinking?
Among other things.
Such as what?
Her polo instructor. She followed him to Florida last fall. After a few weeks of binging on the Gold Coast, she called Jack and begged him to take her back.
You must really love her.
She's wonderful when she's sober.
We have issued our statement. We knew nothing about the apple juice. End of discussion.
All right, we lie about this. It's going to come back and bite us.
No Grayson employees talking to the press about Baby's Finest, and that's final.
I think we should talk to the press. And at the same time, we should look for a baby food company with a terrific image. Merge it with Baby's Finest.
Your problem, Jackie, is that you talk better than you listen. Come on, we got a match.
Nice game.
Shouldn't drink when you play.
Just lock it there. Keep that racket head up. Okay? Swing. Lock your wrist. Okay?
Yeah.
And you swing. Let me get this straight. Now, I pay you $50 an hour to teach my wife tennis so you can put your hand on her ass.
Pete, he was just...
No, honey, that's fair. Maybe, you know, you'd like me to tip him, huh?
Stop it.
Mr. Grayson, come on, this is silly.
What?
You're telling me you didn't have your hand there?
I was just...
Something you want to explain?
Dwight.
I'll handle him. He's drunk, okay?
Hey. Boy, you really tore into that guy. He's all doubled over. Where'd you get him? In the old gut there?
His ribs, I think.
Ribs?
Yeah.
A guy like that won't listen. Sometimes there's only one way to send a message, right? Listen, you have a cabana we can get you cleaned up in.
Thank you.
topical muscle relaxant for tired, achy joints, inflammations, and in Pete's case, chronic impotence. That certainly can't eat away at a man's self-confidence, especially with such an attractive wife.
Sleep. You okay?
Well, I'm just a little embarrassed, that's all.
Oh.
Anyway, thank you.
Yeah. Anytime. Good night, Nora.
Good night,
Jim.
Jim. About this new guy, Prophet?
No, not much. He's hardworking, smart, good man to have in our division at a time like this. Say, what does your shrink say about this insomnia?
He says don't talk to your ex-lovers about your sleeping habits.
Ooh, good shrink. What's he charge?
A lot.
Good morning, Gail. I'm ready to ask you to do me another little favor. I need this memo to appear on Charles Grayson's personal stationery.
This isn't from Mr. Grayson.
Which is why Mr. Walter should never get his hands on it.
Jim?
Jack. Joanne. How are you?
Good. Settling in okay?
I'm just fine, thanks. Just fine.
Good.
The best time to show it to him is just before he addresses the efficiency conference downtown. He'll be in a hurry.
And these are the latest overseas projections.
You confirmed these figures with Zurich?
Yeah, twice. The product liability report. Oh, and this just came in from Charles Grayson.
Jack, regarding Baby's Finest, I've discussed the matter with my father and the board. We're shifting to an open-door policy and will be issuing a statement shortly. When we are approached by the press, we will answer truthfully but diplomatically. Yours, Charles Grayson.
This is your speech. You know it perfectly, but just in case.
Thank you. Sandler, city desk.
Sandy, Sid Weinstock, GNGPR. Listen, ready to do some talking. A little mea culpa on that old baby juice deal, but we're looking for someone we can trust. Now, you used to be buddies with Jack Walters, right?
We were roommates in college.
Right, right. Well, he's got a meeting this evening at the Oak Bar at 8. Should be walking out around 10. Why don't you get down there and catch him before Mike Wallace does?
Charles, and you're ready to talk. Come on, Jack. I know you. You're dying to get it off your chest. Okay. Fire away.
The truth. They say it can be a dangerous thing.
That memo, Gail.
Memo?
The one you gave him before the conference.
We went over the latest figures for projections.
No, the one from Chaz.
I'm sorry, Mr. Walters. This is everything I gave you.
The truth. They say it can also set you free. And now the hole has been created. The job that needs to be filled. And the question on everyone's lips is...
Where's Jack?
Who? Who will become the new president?
Why would you do something like this? We're just getting our lives back together. I'm going to those meetings. I'm resisting every drink that goes by. And what are you doing? You're acting all mighty and moral about baby food. I'm just hanging on by a thread here.
You're not the only one, you know. What do you think, Elizabeth? And I got up this morning saying to myself, hey, I'd like to get canned today. I'd like to be humiliated in front of my staff, escorted to the door by security guards. Now listen to me. I was set up.
I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Oh. Late. I don't want to disturb you. I was calling, getting the machine.
I need to talk to Jack.
We have marriage counseling. One quick question. Gail gave you that memo or showed it to you?
She just showed it to me. Why?
Listen, I'll let you two work this out. And if you have time, I'll be at Dr. Berger's. Bad timing.
Yeah, well, it's okay.
Gail showed you that memo so she wouldn't leave a paper trail.
No, why would Gail do something like this? What does she stand to gain?
Nothing. That's how I know she didn't do it alone. The key is that memo from Chaz. I'll lay odds it's hidden in her computer somewhere.
Yeah, but if she typed it in the computer, it's deleted by now.
Well, there are ways to undelete files, Jack.
Oh.
I'm gonna check on it.
But, don't you need a search warrant for something like that?
I forgot how old-fashioned you are. It's refreshing.
Pete Grayson is certain that empty seat where Jack Walters sat is his now. He just needs that one big deal to put him in the spotlight.
Let me ask you some advice, Pete.
Work on your backhand.
No, this one's about the Cronish metals deal.
Yeah?
Yeah. I got a source from French Parliament. You know all the European metals producers are government-owned.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, right. So this source tells me there's a 30% production cut coming in all the EC countries. Cronish Metals is the only Western company positioned to pick up the slack.
So grab it.
I can't. I mean, it's just too big for me. I'd like to turn the whole thing over to you. I gotta be honest, Pete, I'm choking.
Why?
It's just way too much to cover. I'm still trying to find my parking space in the morning. This ought to be somewhat senior. Someone with a lot of experience.
Well, I tell you, my plate is pretty full. What with Walters gone, trying to figure out who's going to take over the division.
The presidency of the division. Is this the move that'll put him in the spotlight?
What the hell? Be nice to get out of town for a while. Except...
What?
Well, Nora and I made it to the finals of the AIDS charity tournament. There's a formal dinner after. She has to bow out. She'll kill me.
A beautiful woman like that, married to a man like Pete. She must wonder sometimes, is that all there is, all there'll ever be?
Hi.
Hi.
You look... It's a very handsome suit.
Thank you. You look lovely.
Thanks. Come on in. I'll just be a second. Sorry you had to go all the way home to change.
Tux was in the locker room.
Huh. Well, that was silly. You should have just come here. I mean, what do we have a cabana for?
That might not have looked appropriate.
I see. And if Pete found out, you wouldn't want to end up like the tennis instructor.
Lovers and madmen.
Excuse me?
Have such seething brains. Such shaping fantasies that apprehend more than cool reason ever comprehends.
Midsummer Night's Dream.
It's one of my favorite plays.
Mine too.
Really?
I was getting my master's in English Lit when I met Pete. Every year I keep meaning to go back and finish it, but...
You should.
Yeah. Pete hates the idea. All that money for what, he says. Sit around all day memorizing a bunch of dead words. Thinks I should learn how to deal with life. Want to get out of the house, go to work. I don't know, maybe he's right.
Sometimes I hold it half a sin.
To put in words the grief I feel. For words like nature half reveal.
And half conceal the soul within.
Do I seem that sad?
No.
Yes, I do.
Sorry, you can't come in here without an
invitation. Your hands off me, you stupid fat pig!
Now, ma'am, you're making the
scene. What's going on?
Berrigan, the crazy woman thinks the company cheated her out of her inheritance. I better take care of this. It may take a while.
Oh, well, no, you go ahead. I'll explain to Chaz.
Thank you. I had a wonderful evening.
Jim Profit, I'm on top to him, right?
I'll handle this with
him. Very well, sir.
You're hurting me.
I told you I'd get in touch with you tomorrow.
Well, I got lonely.
Broke. Bobby, when are you going to learn to trust me?
About never. Where the hell are we?
It's a surprise.
Great. You're living like this, and I'm in that dump.
It's not my place, Bobby. It's yours.
What?
Paid in full. Free and clear.
Really?
Huh?
Jimmy.
It's one of the best buildings in town. You know why? Privacy. The walls are 3 feet thick. You could do anything in this place, and nobody'd ever know.
Wow. That's great.
You could even scream your head off. Nobody'd ever hear you.
Never was much of a screamer.
That's not what I remember. You know, I bet you could even fire a gun here. Nobody'd hear a thing. That's the kind of money they spent on this building.
Sure you want to get into this with me?
Positive.
Okay. Now, remember, Jazz gets a new mistress every year, usually someone in the company. Now, here's how the pool works. It's $5 a name.
Thank you, Aileen.
Let me tell you where the smart money is. Aileen Morton.
Cosmetics.
Her division does nothing but lose money, and she's making $250,000 a year. How else do you explain it?
We need to talk, Gail. We know this was typed on your computer.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Gail, I know you didn't do it alone. We need to know who made you do it.
I can't.
Forget it, Gail. It's over. Either you tell us who it was right now or we call the police.
Look, I'm sorry. Mr. Walters, I had no choice.
Who was it?
It was Jim Proffitt.
Say, Jim.
Jack.
Yeah.
How are you?
Well, I'm good, Jim. I'm really good, but you're not so good, are you?
Not sure I understand.
Well, let me lay it out for you. I know what you did to Gail. I know what you did to me. Gotcha.
Jack, I know you've been under a lot of pressure.
I see why you went right by me. Boy, you are some piece of business.
Maybe we can sit down and talk about this.
Get your resume in shape, Jim. Get yourself a good lawyer, because you are out of here.
I supposed to do? Joanne found the memo. I can't do this anymore. I won't. Mr. Walters is a good man.
Yeah. He's a good man. He's a very good man. But we have a problem.
You can't scare me anymore.
I'm not trying to scare you, Gail. I just want you to take a look at this new audit I ran. You're gonna see that somebody's embezzled $200,000 from the company using that system of yours.
What?
We're not talking a few hundred dollars a month for Mom's health care. This is a felony, Gail.
That's it. When Joanne gets here, I'm just going to tell the police everything.
But it's your system. Your access codes. It's even your lucky numbers. It's not good, Gail. Not good for you or your mother. By the way, how is she? Have you spoken to her lately?
What?
Why don't you give her a call? Good.
St. John's.
Sarah Connor's room, please.
I'm sorry, she's no longer a patient.
What do you mean she's not there? This is her daughter.
I believe they moved her to Weller Hospital.
Weller Hospital? What is she doing? Well, who signed her out? I don't have a husband. No, never mind. Thank you.
She's in a private room now. With around-the-clock care, intensive therapy, and one of the finest hospitals in the country.
But the money.
It's all taken care of. You'll never have to pay another hospital bill as long as you live. You have company. Just ask yourself one question. What's the best thing for Gail here?
Gail, it's Joanne.
Hi. This is Jeff Sherman. He'll be videotaping your testimony. May we come in?
I can't talk to you.
What?
I'll only talk to Mr. Grayson.
Look, Gail.
I'm sorry, I can't talk to you.
Very good. Very good. Hey. Listen.
everything's going to be all right from now on.
To copy someone's handwriting is more than a simple act of forgery. It's not enough to understand the mechanics. You have to understand the person. How their large, looping L indicates great trust in others. Perhaps a bit too much.
Gail, all we want is to get to the bottom of this. Who leaked the AP files to the Trimp, and who forged that memo to Jack Walters?
You told us it was Mr. Prophet.
Is that true, Gail?
I did say that it was Mr. Prophet, but he didn't have anything to do with it.
Who did?
Mary Miller.
Mary Miller?
Why?
She felt passed over. She wanted Mr. Walters' job.
And she made you fake the memo?
Why did you do it?
This is very difficult. Mary and I are lovers. I mean, we were until I realized that she was just using me to get to Mr. Walters.
And what about that money you embezzled, Gail?
No, I didn't take anything. She did to blackmail me because she knew that I wouldn't hurt Mr. Walters. She's sick. She's very, very sick.
Why did you tell us it was Mr. Prophet?
She told me to blame it on the new guy, but I just can't keep lying for her anymore.
Can you prove any of this, Gail?
These are letters she wrote me.
Well, nothing said here will leave this room. You can go now, Gail. Jim, I'll see to it the situation is rectified.
If I might make a suggestion, firing Mary at this point would be a publicity nightmare. Gay rights, sexual discrimination.
Can't take any more bad press right now.
Her contract is up.
So we don't renew it. No explanation required. Well, Joanne, that wraps it up.
Not quite. What about Gail?
So how do I pack my things?
Yeah. You're my new assistant.
Oh, Mr. Prophet. I'm still looking for that stockholder. I hope I'll have some good news soon.
Thanks, Leo. Thanks a lot. You okay, Mary?
So what do you think? Should I steal some company paper clips?
What the hell they owe you?
Still can't believe it.
None of us can. I mean, there's a chill in that hall. You would not believe.
I mean, I know they're tightening some belts, but...
Mary, don't.
Is it something I said? Was it something I did?
You're gonna drive yourself nuts. Look, it's a fresh start. Get out of this company, get out of the town. I'm willing to lay money. You look back in a few years, this is gonna be the best thing that ever happened to you.
Sorry.
Don't be.
Oh. You know what really irks me?
What's that?
No, I'm never gonna know who Charles Grayson's new mistress is. You're the only thing I'm gonna miss about this place.
I'm gonna miss you too.
I told you on the phone.
I know it wasn't profit. Humor me.
So where are you taking me?
I'll tell you as soon as you tell me who got the Gale.
Can't. I promised Charles it would remain confidential. The important thing is you get your job back.
Oh.
What?
Who's being old-fashioned now? No, for me to be reinstated, Chaz would have to admit he made a mistake, and that's not going to happen. But okay, it's a free country. Let me guess. Pete's his brother. I don't think so. Who's that leave? Mary? Oh, come on, Joanne. Not Mary. You were so sure it was profit.
I know. I let my feelings get in the way.
What feelings?
I told you that when my father died, my older sister raised me. What I didn't tell you is that she had a lot of problems. She would, well, if ever I did anything wrong, she'd get me when I was sleeping.
How?
She'd tie a cord around my neck and I couldn't breathe.
Oh, Joe.
Oh, it's all right. I mean, it's a long time ago. It's just this thing I see in his eyes. It reminds me of her. Maybe I'm crazy.
And maybe you're not. The security guard at G&G showed me the sign-in logs. A woman came to visit Prophet 4 times.
Really?
Her name's Bobby Stokowski. She's the wife of a farmer from Tulsa, Oklahoma. Picked up in recent years on drug charges.
Are you Columbo?
No, just unemployed. Anyway, she came to town 4 weeks ago. No job, no money. And the only person she's had any contact with is Jim Prophet. Right? So 11 days ago, she put $200,000 down on that penthouse, cash.
What would a woman like that have to do with a guy like Prophet?
Something we should find out about, don't you think?
Jimmy, pick up the phone. I'm tired of talking to this machine. Jimmy, I want to see you. I need you, baby. Mommy needs her bad boy. Jimmy, pick up. Now. Jimmy.
Here's to Kronisch Metals, soon to be a division of Grayson. Grayson.
Congratulations, Pete.
Well, I tell you, it was the sweetest deal and one of the easiest. That whole French thing we found out about. I mean, this company is prime. We're going to pick up all that Euro slack.
We will when it's closed.
Hey, it's closed. I closed it. You want to see the letter of intent?
No, I want to see a completed contract. Now he's kicked out at the 11th hour.
Well, that's why I'm on top of it, Chaz.
The trick is, you want to dance that fly across the water. You're trying to tease the fish up, and it takes a light hand. But the real joy of it, the real joy, is the solitude. That's what keeps me coming back.
The real joy of fishing has got nothing to do with why Chaz keeps going back.
What do you mean?
That's his little story. Fishing. See, what he really does, he heads up north to a hotel. And he and some lucky babe, they get back to nature for real.
That sounds romantic.
Yeah. What the hell? He's a grown man. What the wife doesn't know. Just can't figure out who he's doing this year. Old Chaz.
Shop talk says it's Aileen Morton. From cosmetics?
Well, I don't know. But Chaz, he loves to keep us guessing.
Good night. Don't stay up too late.
Looks like there's no doubt about it, buddy. You're the next president of acquisitions.
Chaz is very proud of you, honey.
Chaz. Let me tell you about little Chaz. He can't stand to see anybody in the family do better than him.
Pete.
Well, kids, got dugout seats for the Giants in the playoffs. He gets into trouble, he's got to stay home. So what he does, he goes into my room, gets a staple gun, and he staples himself in the head.
Yeah.
And then he goes crying to Mom and says that I did it. So neither of us goes to the game. I mean, if he couldn't go, then nobody could. That is little Chaz in a nutshell. Well, if you're done looking at her tits, I'll take a check.
God, Pete.
Can we drop you?
I drove.
Right. Well, thanks. Again.
Sure.
I've tried to get him to cut down, but...
Look, it's not your problem.
I hate him when he gets like this.
I hate what it must be doing to you.
Well, good night, Jim.
Good night, Nora.
Jim, I'm meeting the Cronish lawyers in 10 minutes. I can't find the letter of intent.
Don't worry, I got everything. Gail, will you bring in 2 copies of the Cronish agreement?
Yes, sir.
The damn deal is so complicated. Canadians, Japanese, all these cutoffs and deadlines. One thing doesn't get signed on time, the whole thing goes kablooey.
2 copies.
Thanks. You know what your boss is? He's a damn lifesaver.
Mm.
When you want someone to love you, open your heart. When you want someone obsessed with you, close it.
Hello?
Nora, it's Jim.
Hi.
Hi. Listen, I'd like to see you. It's kind of important.
Sure, where?
I was thinking the same place we met last week. Okay?
Okay.
Good.
Bye.
Hey, Jim. I'm sorry, did I startle you? If I came up during business hours, I think they'd probably throw me out.
Yeah, they probably would.
Anyway, listen, there's something that I have to tell you. I guess I just want you to know that, I'm sorry about what I said. I know it wasn't you who leaked the memo.
Hey, no hard feelings, huh?
No, not at all. Not at all.
Maybe this means you'll be coming back to us.
Well, just have to see about that. So, thanks for letting me clear the air.
Anytime, Jack.
Yeah.
Take care.
Yeah.
I didn't mean to sound so urgent on the telephone. I hope it didn't cause a problem.
No. Pete's usually passed out by 9:30.
Nora, there's something I need to tell you. I don't know how to say it.
Well, look, God knows I've dumped enough of my problems on you, so...
I can't see you anymore.
Jim.
I know, it sounds stupid. Probably don't know what I'm talking about. Trust me.
I know what you're talking about.
I'd really like to be your friend.
No, I know.
It hurts too much to be around you. I'm sorry.
Well, drink, Jack?
No, none for me, thanks.
I'm sorry. It's weird being here with you again. I'm uncomfortable.
Yeah, so am I. So can I have a drink now?
I'll join you.
Profit's paying this woman off. His checking account and savings account do not show it.
Well, maybe I was wrong about him.
I don't think so. Everything about this guy, his TRWs, personnel files, are all a little too neat.
Neat?
Like the perfect lie. We need to keep looking. Into the woman, maybe. She's not so perfect. Ah! You remember? Oh, my bad little boy remembers.
Hi.
Hi.
Look, Dr. Berger says that I should try to understand your point of view. So you're with Joanne until 1 a.m. because...
Because I'm trying to figure out what's really going on with the company.
Well, I'm trying to figure out what's really going on between you and Joanne.
Nothing. Nothing is going on.
Well, Jack, I really want us to get through this.
We will. We will.
I'm gonna jump in the shower. Why don't you watch the little TV?
Over 200 parking lots. That is a big company. One we might be interested in acquiring. It's all in a tri-county area. Right, well, how many hospitals or nursing homes use your services? It is a lot.
After talking with Mr. Stokowski's cousins, I'm sure he's got to be in one of the 16 hospitals or 10 nursing centers in the Tri-County area.
Oh, that'll make it a lot easier. And it's nice and close by, huh?
Yes, it is.
I got to tell you, Mr. Prophet, I'm impressed. You putting in this kind of effort for one little customer.
They're all important, Leo. What's more important is we settle our debts. Let me know the minute you find him, okay?
Oh, I've gone back 10 years. Every newspaper in Tulsa, there's no record of a Roberta Monroe or a Bobby Stokowski.
And go back 15.
Sure. We'll go back 15. Stokowski, Roberta. All publications, Oklahoma 1978 to 1983. Had no idea police work could be so exciting. Oh, my God.
What? What'd you find?
Well, it looks like Roberta Stokowski has an interesting background, all right. She was the second wife of a man named Arnold Stokowski, who had a son from a previous marriage.
13 years ago, he chained his father to a bed and set fire to him.
The hell would make a kid do something like that to his own father?
I've never cheated on Pete before, not once. I don't care anymore.
No. Not here. Not now. I don't want you getting up and going home to him after.
You're not like anyone I've ever known.
I want us to go away together. Have a weekend. A whole day and a whole night.
I'll find a way. This weekend. Don't ask me to wait any longer.
Ask me no more, my dear.
No more, dear. No more. For to touch, I yield.
Our lives are a trail of paper. What we buy, where we go, who we see.
Morning, Eileen.
Morning.
For instance, a suite booked by Eileen Morton at the Northview Lodge in Connor Valley.
Connor Valley?
The Northview Lodge. You know it?
Oh, yeah. They have a great restaurant there. I always stop and pig out my way to the fat farm.
Well, here's what I'm thinking. You tell Pete you're going to the spa and you meet me at the Northview Lodge.
All right.
I can't believe we're doing this.
Oh, we're doing this. Trust me.
Trust. The foundation of any marriage. If broken, it can hurt even the strongest ones. And kill the weak ones.
See you Monday.
Prophet.
Mr. Prophet, thank God you left this number.
What's the problem, Nick?
I don't even know where to start. It's Cronish Metals. Somehow a date on the letter of intent got changed.
You're kidding.
No, it's the pay or play buyout. If it's not signed by end of business today, we get hit with a $20 million kill fee.
Nick, calm down.
You don't understand. Charles Grayson's on one of his fishing trips, God knows where. And if his signature is not on here by end of business today...
Call Pete Grayson. No. Take the contract to his house right now. Explain the situation. I guarantee you Pete will find Charles and get it signed.
Okay. Okay, I'm on my way. Thanks, Mr. Prophet.
Suddenly, Pete sees his entire future crumbling. All because of one signature and the change of a single date. He needs to see Charles, even if it means interrupting one of his fishing trips in Connor Valley.
I'm Nora Grayson. I should have a reservation?
Yes, there's a message for you. The gentleman said it was urgent.
Is there a phone I can use?
Right over there.
Thanks.
Hello?
Jim, what's the matter? Are you still at home?
Yes, Nora, I am.
Nora,
Pete's a friend of mine. How can we do this to him?
Jim,
Nora, I don't know how I'd ever look at him again. I don't know what I'd say. It'll be the same for you. I mean, how are you going to feel when you see him again?
Jim, I don't know what to do.
Just give me a sec. Let me pull myself together here.
Northview Lodge, how may I direct your call?
This is for you, sir.
Thank you. Yes?
Sorry to disturb you, Mr. Grayson, but there's someone in the lobby who insists upon seeing you.
Thank you. Excuse me.
Nora, we both know we can't do this. I'll always be your friend.
I love you, Jim.
Take care, Nora.
Nora? What are you doing here?
Oh, Jess. Hi. I was just on my way for a weekend at the spa, and I thought I'd stop for Pete.
With my wife?
Pete, listen.
With my wife?
Oh, my God. Pete! Get someone down here. Call some help.
Pete, what the hell are you doing?
Eileen.
Found him. Joan Kenderson Nursing Home. They have a special ward there for the infirm, particularly burn victims. He's registered under the name of Stevens.
Good work, Leo.
Sheriff Crewe, can you hear us?
Sure can, Miss Meltzer. Only you don't have to call me sheriff. I got knocked out of that job 10 years ago.
Thanks for looking over the material we faxed. Is there anything you can tell us?
Well, Arnold Stokowski was not what you'd call a real loving parent. Now, I'm not saying he deserved to get torched, but that kid of his, he put up with a hell of a lot.
Well, we were more interested in what you can tell us about Bobby.
They lived way out in the middle of no place. Kid never went to school, didn't have no friends. He used to hear some weird stories how Stokowski reared him after his first wife ran off.
Yeah, actually, we're more
what kind of stories?
Well, Stokowski had this big old ranch, but he was a cheap bastard, wouldn't hire no help. Your old baby on his hands. So we just stuck him in a big old moving box. Toss in food, clean it out once a week, kind of like he did for his horses and cows. Well, the kid had something else. A little hole cut out of the box so he could see TV. On day and night. Reared by TV, imagine that. Well, things didn't get much better after Bobby came along. One time, it's been a year, year and a half before the fire, got a call down the hospital. Stokowski's boy, Jimmy, was sewing up his hand.
What happened?
Stokowski got drunk, bent the kid down, picked up a knife, carved a cross in the back of his hand.
A cross?
Said the boy didn't have no religion.
Which hand?
Which hand?
Where'd he cut the boy?
Well, right, I think, on the back. Big old cross, deep and bloody.
That's what Bobby has on him. The boy who set fire to his father. It's Jim Proffitt.
Then he smacks him on the head like that. Then he pokes his coconut into the letterpress. See, like that. Then he says, I'll squeeze the cider out of your Adam's apple.
All right.
Hello, this is the Joan Kenderson Nursing Home. Is this Mrs. Stevens?
What's wrong?
I'm sorry, but you should probably come down here right away. Your husband has had an aneurysm. He may not last the day.
What?
He wants to see you.
He's asking to see you.
I'm on my way.
Thanks, Gil. I really appreciate your help.
Excuse me. Can we have a word with you?
Who are you?
I'm Joanne Meltzer. This is Jack Walters. We'd like to ask you a few questions.
Well, I'm sorry, but I don't have time right now. I have a sick husband.
Wait a minute.
Oh, I'm sorry. We just found Jim Proffitt's father. Proffitt's car. He's here.
He's gonna kill him. Wait. Excuse me. My sister just came in. She has red hair and a tan suit. Could you tell me what room her husband's in?
Right now. They took my blood this morning.
Would you believe it? They dropped the vial.
Just a minute. I'll be right with you.
Where the hell is he?
What now?
Check the other floors.
Hey. Don't I know you?
My old man done to me. I paid for what I've done to you. I paid all these years. Haven't I suffered enough?
Shh. It's all right, Mr. Stevens. Dad, I'm not here to hurt you. I'm here to get you out.
You mean that?
Come on.
We're going home.
I'm sorry, Mrs. Stevens. We have the orderlies looking for him. He probably wheeled himself outside for a smoke.
With an aneurysm?
The elevator's down there.
I know, Dan.
Yeah. What are you doing, Jody?
Right behind you, Pop.
What are we doing here?
I told you, Dad. You're going home.
No. You said we're going home.
Did I?
Pulse.
Get a doctor. Not here.
The parking lot. He's gone.
Could he have an aneurysm?
No, this was a heart attack.
But the hospital called me this morning and said he'd had an aneurysm.
Believe me, Mrs. Stevens, if he'd had any kind of aneurysm, I would have called you personally.
What the hell do you think you're doing?
I'm just putting together some moving boxes for you.
Oh, you think I'm going? You think that little trick you pulled at the hospital's gonna fool anybody?
I certainly hope so.
Well, let me tell you something. I'm gonna order an autopsy. Uh-huh, that's right, a full damn autopsy. You think you're gonna blow my plan? Then you're going to jail.
I want you to have your personal items out of here by 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. The furniture and the fixtures stay. I paid for them.
Did you hear what I just said?
Mm-hmm.
They're gonna find what you did in that autopsy.
No. What they're gonna find is a noticeable but not excessive amount of potassium, which is secreted during a heart attack.
Oh, is that what you gave him, potassium? Oh, you think I'm gonna let him buy it was a heart attack?
You should. Because if you don't, I'll be forced to give him this. It's got your fingerprints on it, traces of potassium, and a street-grade heroin. If they look closely enough, they're gonna find that in Dad's system.
You used my... You made it look like I...
Well, go ahead. It's just a visual aid. The real syringe is in a very safe place, and it'll stay there as long as nothing happens to me.
Well, why would I kill him?
$12,000. It's a lot of money to a junkie.
What $12,000?
The insurance. Okay, leave your keys on the counter. I have a set. Turn off all the lights before you go. That's it. Oh, take care.
That's it? That's it? That 12 grand, that's all I get after all this? Jimmy, please. Please.
Okay. You can have the TV. But remember, Mom, television's bad for you.
Grayson's office just called. He's ready for you.
Well, a crooked tie wouldn't look too smart on the new president of acquisitions.
Thank you, Gail. It's good to see Gail understands the basic nature of business. We adapt or pay the price.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Nice going, Jim.
George. Hello, Alicia.
Jim, how are you?
Good. You know, I was talking to some of the boys in legal. So you can sue that rock you fell off of.
Well, I don't think there are going to be any lawsuits, unfortunately. Anyways, Jim, you've done excellent work under trying circumstances, and that deserves a promotion. This isn't official yet, but you're going to be our new senior vice president of acquisitions.
Vice president.
I know it's a big move up, and you haven't been with us long, but you'll do great. Jack has to approve it, of course, but that's just a formality.
Jack?
I've been looking for a way to put this whole baby food mess behind us, and Jack has come up with a terrific solution. It seems he goes way back with the president of a company called Healthy Home. Now, Healthy Home has a great image, but no capital. And Baby's Finest has a lot of capital.
But a few image problems, to say the least. However, fold Baby's Finest into Healthy Home, and you earn a small fortune for G&G, which is always cause for celebration. What Charles didn't tell anyone was that Healthy Home would not agree to the deal unless Jack was reinstated as president. Charles may hate Jack, but he loves money.
Trying it on for size?
Jack.
There you are. I just wanted to say well done.
Thank you.
Everybody's kind of curious why you came back. We heard you had a number of other good offers.
Well, Jim, there are people here I care about. Problems I want to see taken care of.
What kind of problems?
Well, let me put it this way, Jim. You know what the greatest danger to a company like this is? It's not hostile takeover or the economy going sour. It's when you see something you know is wrong and you look the other way.
You're talking about Baby's Finest?
Yeah, among other things.
Huh?
Remember Wayne Gresham? Died of a heart attack. You took his job.
I never met him.
You sure?
Positive.
As it struck me kind of funny, I was at a nursing home the other day and another fellow named Stokowski died of a heart attack. You ever met him?
You think there might be some connection between Wayne and this Stokowski fellow?
Oh, I know there is.
Well, I look forward to working with you, Jack.
Me too. Oh, by the way, I spoke with Chaz about your promotion. We're gonna have to put a hold on that for the time being. But you should know, Jim, I got my eye on you.
Joanne, I was wondering if maybe you'd like to come have a drink with me.
I don't think so.
Have I done something to offend you?
No, I just find it hard to look at you sometimes.
Why? Remind you of someone? Your sister? You know, I hear she's doing real well at the institution. They're gonna let her out soon. You must have mixed feelings about that after what she did to you. Joanne, one thing we have to remember. To forgive. You can't run from your past. And you can't run from yourself.
And you can't run from me, son of a bitch.
Well, you can't expect everyone to like you. And you can't expect everything to work out exactly the way you plan it. Because life is full of surprises. You never really know what's around the next corner. But if you do the best you can, and if you give 100%, then you can go to sleep with a clear conscience. What you didn't win today, you can always win tomorrow. And remember, never lose sight of your goals. Because there are some people who are really worth that extra time and effort. And in the end, I believe if you work hard enough, everyone comes around.